Good morning, Revolution Church. So happy to be back with you all today. I want to say hello to those of you who are watching online this morning, too. We're glad you're here. Okay, I have to ask you a question today. Have you ever heard of this phrase? And if you have, would you just like raise your hand or kind of wave at me? It goes like this. Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. Anybody ever heard that? Nice. Okay, I'm good. Okay, so I want you to think about that. Is that statement true? Don't answer yet. Just think about it in your mind. Ruminate, if you will. Is imitation the sincerest form of flattery? That's the question that we're asking today. And for the sake of simplicity, I'm gonna say it this way. Is imitating or copying something or someone the best compliment that we can give to them? That's the premise that I want to start this message on at. Because some of us spent a weekend learning about what it means to have an undivided heart. And so I want to lean hard into that today because I believe that God is calling us to look set apart. But more than just look set apart, I think he's calling us to act set apart and to be set apart. So is imitating or copying someone the best compliment that we can give to them? Isn't my family cute? They're not here, so I had to get a picture of them. Okay, I'm going to show you some pictures, and then you guys can decide for yourself if imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. Hit us with it. Okay, so we have a Sharpie or a Scurple. I'm just asking, which one do you want to have in an emergency? All right, which one do you want to write your masking tape with? Okay, go to the next one for me. The wall of fake Dr. Pepper. That's what it is. Let me point out a few of my favorites. We got Dr. Perky over here. Anybody drink a Dr. Perky? I needed one this morning because of what time I had to get up. Dr. Spice. Ooh, spicy. Okay. All right. We've got, is the E silent over here on refreshe? Is that how you say it? Refreshe? I don't know. I'm asking. Big K. That's where I come from. We got Big K. Dr. Stripes in the middle. He is very organized, I can tell already. We got Food Club Dr. Wow up there. And let's see. Oh, my personal favorite, Dr. Thunder. Anybody ever drink a Dr. Thunder? Amen in the house of God. Okay, let's go to the next one. Okay, so over here we have a 7-Eleven. And then right here, we have what is called the 11-7. And I want you to search your heart and pray about this church. I'd love to know which one do you want to use the bathroom at. In Jesus' name, which one are you hoping you get for the bathroom? You want Bobo or the real thing? I'm just asking, is imitation the sincerest form of flattery? I mean, the 7-Eleven ain't looking too good either. We don't have Quick Trip in Indiana. Pray for me. Okay, next one. Okay, so how many of you played with Ninja Turtles or watched the show when you were a kid? Well, here, we don't have a Ninja Turtle. We have a new style Ninja Tortoise. Tortoise. Okay, and just so they don't get sued, they made sure and put a sticker on his chest to let you know he is a tortoise. He is not a turtle. Okay, maybe when he gets saved, he'll be a turtle. I don't know. Okay, all right, let's go to the next one. His eyes look evil. Will you go back for me? I forgot to point out this. Look at his eyes. He does not look like one of the good guys. Okay? All right, next one. Thank you. Okay. Some of us have an oil of Olay budget, and some of us have an oil of okay budget. That's like the wish version of oil of Olay. Okay, let's go to the next one. If you know, you know. Listen, I don't even know what to say. You're not going to be that sad, but you're going to be a little sad, you know? It's just not going to taste quite the same. All right, they're jumbo, though. So you get more, but it tastes a little less good, okay? That's it. All right, next one. You can't make this stuff up. I love the internet, man. Okay, this is the Boba version of what game? Let's say it together. Guess who? Okay, look at the art on this. I mean, this guy in the front, he has some eyebrows, just some, that's all I can say is he is really on trend with his eyebrows right now. Okay, they all look like a little bit like the characters, but not quite, you know, they're just like almost there. That's what happened here. You get to be the detective though, so that's exciting. All right, go to the next one. Okay, so let's look at Arm & Hammer. First of all, if you'll notice the price tag on this, I feel like that's a little bit high, but I'm no prices, right? It says $6. I don't know who's spending $6 for baking soda, but we need to talk afterwards. Okay, if you got a stench, like you got Arm & Hammer, but if your fridge smells like The Walking Dead, you get to use Arm & Hatchet because you are going to take care of that. You know what I'm saying? Okay, next one. Is that like, does it have an E on the end, like the Refresh-A, Capri Sun-A? I don't know, but it contains 12% fruit, so that's exciting. I wonder if the bag works as well, you know? Okay, go to the next one. Okay, at the bottom, I don't know if you can see this, but it says our version of Lady Gaga fame. Crazy Lady, that's the name of the perfume. That's the joke, that's it. It made itself. Okay, and it's also $2.99, which is probably less expensive than that meat dress she wore that one time. Okay, here are the Golden Twins. I wonder if they last as long as Twinkies and they'll be around in the apocalypse with the cockroaches and stuff. You think? I don't know. We'll find out. All right, next one. This is my favorite. I saved the best for last. They're more than meets the eye. You just can't make it up. It's just too good. Somebody's getting sued over that. Okay, so I want to ask you one more time. Is imitation the sincerest form of flattery, church? What if I told you, though, that most people don't know that full phrase? The full phrase, there's a second part to that quote that nobody ever quotes. Has anybody ever heard the second part to that? Okay, good. I was hoping nobody would, so I could surprise you with it, you know, element of surprise and stuff. Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery that mediocrity can pay to greatness. Is anybody in the house of God this morning? Do you see where we're going today? Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery that mediocrity can pay to greatness. Let that sink in for a second. Nowhere do we see that more than in the OG story of all stories, the beginning of the beginning, the reason that we're sitting here today, and that is in a garden somewhere. If you're breathing, temptation has touched your life. And honestly, the scriptures tell us that all have sinned and fallen short of God's glorious standard. And hear me when I say it is a glorious standard. But we've all fallen short of it. We've all been tempted to and we've all given into it. Amen? Okay, let's start there this morning. So what does temptation have to do with imitation? And why does it even matter? Well, I want to invite you to turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 2. We're going to be in verses 15 and 16 this morning, first of all. Here's where it starts. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free." Look at your neighbor and say, "You are free." "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden. But you must not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly what? Die." Now I want you to flip over a page to Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 7, and here's where it all went wrong, like an old country song. "Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, 'Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?' The woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die.' 'You will not certainly die,' the serpent said to the woman, 'for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' When the woman saw the fruit of the tree was good for food," say good for food, "pleasing to the eye," say pleasing to the eye, "and desirable for gaining wisdom," say desirable for gaining wisdom, "she took some and she ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it." May God add his blessing to the reading of his word today. Let's pray. Father, I love this church so much, and it's just an honor to serve them this morning. I pray that I could wash their feet with the water of the word of God, and that you would clarify any misconceptions that they have about you in this moment, and that truly, Lord, that you would allow our hearts to be united to fear your name. It's in your name that I pray and believe. Amen. All right, now you have heard it said that imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. But I'm here to tell you that you just read about a mediocre attempt to imitate greatness. And it looks so obvious to you right now. But I want you to know that Adam and Eve didn't have a wheel of okay back then. All right? So before you go too hard on Adam and Eve for touching that temptation and giving way to sin, I want to let you know that you and I would have totally doomed humanity too. So don't be throwing her under the bus, girls and guys, okay? Eventually, we would have given in to. So let's give Eve a break today. But we need to start with the idea of what a temptation is if we're going to figure this out together, okay? So I want to be really careful with how we talk about this because I don't want anybody leaving this room today and believing that they sin when they are tempted. Are you hearing me? Because temptation is not the same as sin. All right, a temptation is what we would consider an allure, a desire, an attraction towards someone or something. It is not a sin to be tempted. In fact, Jesus himself was tempted. Remember in Matthew 4 when he was in the desert? Here's when it becomes a sin. When we let that desire be met by a mediocre attempt to copy God's best for us, that's a sin. You hear me, church? When you allow that particular temptation to be met by a mediocre attempt to copy God's best, that is sin. All right, temptation in and of itself is not sin, but I will tell you with this, you're standing in the doorway to disobedience, so you better decide which way you're going. Am I moving toward Jesus? Am I looking toward him, or am I moving away from him with this choice right now? It grieves my heart, especially for you that are in Generation Z and even younger, because we are living in a time when we're told that our temptations equal our identity. Okay? We're told that we're inundated. I mean, just everybody is screaming it from the rooftops. They are lying to us because they tell us that who we are is found in where we struggle. That's not true, though. We're overwhelmed with these messages that teach us to be defined by the things that tempt us. They're asking us to be defined by our temptations. Do you get what I'm saying this morning? Okay, and so here's the truth. If you are living by your feelings and your temptations, you're going to have a hard life. I heard a Bible teacher say a couple weeks ago, she was like, you know what? My feelings can ride in the car, but they cannot drive. That's a word for somebody this morning. My feelings can ride, but they can't drive. Do our temptations and our feelings define us, or can our identity be rooted more deeply than that? Because our temptations will change throughout our lives. And if our feelings are driving, who knows where we're going to end up? Let me tell you what. I work for a recovery ministry, and I'm in the jail every week talking to women. And what happened to them was they got in the car and they let their temptations and their feelings drive them. And they thought they were going to the Hilton Garden Inn. And where they found themselves was riding in a hoopty all the way to the Gray Bar Motel. And I'm here to tell you, if they were standing here today, they'd say, don't do it. It's a bobo ride. By the way, I learned the term bobo from North Carolina. So thank you all very much for that. From the beginning, Satan sought to do three things to us. What are they? Steal. Gold star for everybody. Good job. And what he does to do that is he takes these desires that God has placed in us to point to an intelligent creator and a loving God and twist them up, twisting those desires by tapping us on the shoulder and leading us away from the one who can actually meet those desires. Twisting it, okay? So if we were to define temptation in our own language, we would say temptation is a twisting of the truth. When you twist the truth, it's got just enough that you really got to pay attention to catch it, don't you? Did God say that you couldn't eat any tree? It couldn't eat from any tree? No, he didn't. He said, you are free. That's what he said. See how he just simply twisted that conversation just enough to deceive her. One pastor said it this way. He said, a temptation is an opportunity to accomplish a good thing in a bad way. For example, it's a good thing to pass a school test, but it's a bad thing to do it by cheating. It's a good thing to pay your bills, but a bad thing to be tempted to steal the money for the payment for it. So we have to fight against this truth twisting that Satan does to us, but we got to fight against something else too. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we have to fight against something else. And that is that there are plenty of well-meaning Christians who will vilify the desires that God gave us rather than addressing the temptation that's twisting up that good and holy desire. They want to put more rules and laws on you. And so it's often done out of a heart to avoid doing wrong, but it ends up with people thinking that the God-given desire is wrong instead of the temptation to act on it in an ungodly way. God defined what is good in the garden up until the day that Adam and Eve started to define it for themselves. And I just need you to know that the devil is not going to come at you with a dagger or a scream mask. He's not going to come looking like Jason or the guy with the chainsaw. He's not coming with the Freddy Krueger look with the warts on his nose. He's not coming with the dagger. He's coming with the Dr. Thunder. He's coming with something that looks just enough like what you really want. He's coming with something that's just slightly different. He's not going to come at you where you can tell it's him. If you saw Freddy Krueger, you'd run the other way. Gotta go. That's the devil right there. He's going to come at you with something that looks so much like what you really want. Will you buy it? This is the answer, the message that God has for you today. Church, I believe that God has a word for you today, and it's this. We've talked about how it's been taught to us that imitation is the sincerest form of flattery, but we do not flatter a holy God when we reach for a cheap imitation of his good and perfect gifts and will for our lives. So how does temptation twist the truth for us? Go to 1 John chapter 2. We're going to be in verses 15 through 17. Hear the word of God. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away. But whoever does the will of God lives forever. Is that good news today? You'll be amazed and maybe a little bit disgusted to learn that Satan has been using the same temptation playbook to confuse and afflict God's people throughout the annals of history. Okay, we see him manipulate holy desires in these three ways. First of all, lust of the flesh. Now, there are normal and holy desires that God has placed within us humans to keep us alive and to keep the human race going. Is that true? Okay, so things like hunger and thirst and tiredness and sexual expression, they're good and holy because they are God's idea and they let us know that we are finite, right? And I have to tell you that we started having very frank discussions with our children about the important concepts that involve physical desire long before puberty because we wanted them to hear God's perspective first. Okay, so we talked to them. We tried to beat all the kids on the playground to the punch. We tried to beat the pornography industry to the punch. We tried to beat all of the factors that are working against their purity to the punch because I want them to know the real thing so they can spot the counterfeit a mile away. Okay, what about that is God asking you to do? Because let me tell you, what happens is when you get to design a universe and galaxy, when you get to create it, when you get to make it, you get to decide the rules for that. But up until then, guess what? You're living by the rules of a creator. And when you get your own galaxy, congratulations, you can do what you'd like. Till then, there is one God. And he gets to decide how he uses the gifts, how you use the gifts he gives you. But the problem is, we reach for the counterfeit instead of going for the real thing. Lust of the flesh is what Satan uses to appeal to our appetites. He takes the truth that God knows best and he whispers to us. He says, might you know better than God does about this? Anybody ever heard that whisper? Might you know a little bit better than God? And so temptation tells us that we know better than God. Have you ever felt that way? Look inside your heart right now. Have you ever said, I know better about this? God's real stupid about this. He's God, okay? He ain't stupid. He knows what he's talking about. A few years ago, I caught my son, who's now 12 years old, eating cottage cheese under the bed with his bare hands. Maybe you don't want to take advice from me anymore. I don't know. I asked him after I recovered from the initial shock, because what do you say? He's shoveling it in. Like, he has these two tiny shovels. Just, there's cottage cheese everywhere. I'm going to need some Arm and Hatchet to move on past that. It's just insane, right? And I looked at him and I said, Ty, what are you doing? And he looked at me and he blinked a couple times and he said, I thinked about it and I just couldn't help it. Just couldn't help it. Eve saw that the fruit was good for food. So how does this temptation lead to sin? Well, we get accustomed to meeting our own needs in our own ways. And when God decides to meet that need in a different way or delay the meeting of that need in a holy way, we feel that it doesn't satisfy like our way would. We don't trust God to meet the desires he gave to our bodies in his time and in his way. It's that Veruca Salt syndrome from Willy Wonka. I don't care how. I want it. She was a bad egg. But in our microwave culture, where everything comes to us immediately, there's instant gratification everywhere we look. The choice for us is often a Dr. Thunder now or a Dr. Pepper at the right time. You know what I'm saying, church? The temptation is toward a mediocre imitation of the greatness for God's good plan for us in our physical body. And you know that our physical bodies are tied to our emotions. Our gut and our brain are tied together. All these things affect every part of you. Will you let God meet that need? Second one is lust of the eyes. Hey guys, did you know that your eyes have cravings? Have you ever heard the phrase, feast your eyes on this? Our eyes have cravings. We live in a world that's obsessed with appearance. In fact, many of us learn to obsess about our image or what we look like to those around us before we're even old enough to understand what's happening to us. In a materialistic society, we're taught that in order to be somebody, we must have certain things or we must look a certain way. In other words, I am what I have and I am what people say about me. When we desire the next hot car, the latest phone, the designer clothes, the biggest house, and all kinds of material wealth above that of spiritual blessing, we fall into the devil's trap of believing that those things are going to satisfy us. Those things are going to satisfy and be sufficient for us. And I'm not here to be down on a nice car or if you have money. Wonderful. I hope you use it for the kingdom of God. That's great. But I'm saying, what's your priority, church? There's nothing wrong with looking nice or having nice clothes. But when we are compelled to the point of an obsession and we believe that we genuinely need those things in order to be content, we have been sold a bill of goods. We begin to see everything as something to possess, and we begin to love people or love things and use people instead of loving people and using things. That's what happens with lust of the eyes. The lust of the eyes appeals to our affections. What do we care about? What matters to us? And so temptation is whispering this lie in our ear that we need more than God will provide for us. Temptation twists us into believing that we need more than God provides. Hoarding our possessions, trying to gather more and more instead of sharing what we have, because we believe that we will always have what we need from Christ Jesus. What does Philippians 4:19 say? My God will supply all your needs according to his riches in Christ Jesus our Lord. And if your thoughts have you constantly comparing yourself to other people while focusing on what you don't have or what you don't look like, Satan is having his way in your life today, brother. Satan's having his way in your life today, sister, because you are accepting a cheap, mediocre imitation of the provision of a holy God. He has better for you than that. The third one is the pride of life. And the pride of life describes the arrogant spirit of self-sufficiency. And when we say pride of life, maybe you're like me and you think of the Lion King, like a pride rock and Samanya. Anyway, that's what I always think of when I say pride of life. But it expresses a desire for recognition, for applause, for status, for advantage in life, okay? It's evident in things like one-upmanship when somebody's telling a story and we got to tell a better one. Okay? When you interrupt people so that you can get your point across. When you listen to say something and not listen to learn something. I got a story for you. So there was a turtle. Perhaps he was a new style ninja tortoise. Who even knows? But he wanted to spend the winter in Florida, but he knew he couldn't walk that far. Or if he did, it wouldn't be winter anymore. You know what I'm saying? And so he convinced a couple of eagles to help him. And so each one of them took an end of a piece of rope and put it in their beaks to fly. And he clamped his little tortoisey jaws in the middle, okay? And so they took off, and it was smooth sailing. I mean, smooth flying, whatever. Anyway, he was going with them, and he was in his teeth, you know, and they were flying him to Florida until that moment when somebody on the ground noticed what was happening. They were like, oh, my word, look, it's a turtle flying with two eagles. Isn't that amazing? Wow, I wonder who came up with that idea. And the turtle goes, I did. Because he thought, you get it? I'll just need your help, okay? The pride of life appeals to our ambitions, like the one that makes me hope that you laugh at my jokes today. I want to talk to you about pride and insecurity, though, because I think a lot of people think that they're opposite things. Pride is opposite from insecurity. They're the same exact thing. Did you know that? They're the same exact thing, and it's pride of life. Is what it is. Because insecurity tells you that you should think less of yourself, and pride tells you that you should think more of yourself, and Jesus and true humility tell you, stop thinking about yourself. It's the same problem. You're thinking about yourself, whether you are belittling yourself or making much of yourself. You are thinking about yourself too much. So the good news is you can think about Jesus more and think about yourself less. And that might not get me anybody's lunch today, but you know what I'm like? I'm just here to be honest with you, and I think that we owe it to the next generation to be authentic about what insecurity really is, because it is killing our students. It is killing our students. And we have to set an example for them. We have to say, you know what? I'm not thinking about myself. I'm thinking about Jesus. Thinking about the kingdom of God. Temptation tells us that everything revolves around us and not God. That's the lie of the temptation, of the pride of life, of pride and insecurity and ambition and all the things that the world tells us that we must possess to be successful. Tells us that it's on our shoulders, that it revolves around us instead of around God. And I'm going to tell you right now that Eve fell for this pattern of temptation, and she committed the very first sin. Because in Genesis 3:6, we found out that it was good for food. You remember that? We found out that it was pleasing to the eyes. We found out that it was good for gaining knowledge. And so right there, he started lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. He's been doing it since the beginning of time. That's great, Lauren. We all experience temptation. It comes in these three forms. What do I do when I'm tempted? Anybody? What do I do now? Now that I know his strategy, what do I do? I'm going to give you four words. Can you remember four words till next week? Hopefully Brad will say them again, maybe. Brad, I love you, man. Just remind him next week. Four words. Often imitated, never duplicated. good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ, often imitated, never duplicated. Nothing will satisfy like the true character and love and provision of the Lord. And it may seem like the real thing, but you need to stop and ask yourself, is it cheaply made? Are the colors quite as bright? Is the taste just a little bit off? It's not the same. Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery that mediocrity can pay to greatness. So will you settle for mediocre when you can have the goodness of God himself? Some of us have believed a lie that I want to dismantle today in the name of Jesus. God is not holding out on you. I'll say that one more time. God is not holding out on you. If you've been believing that lie, you tear it down today in Jesus' name. Because here's the truth. God is asking you to hold out for him. God is not holding out on you. He's asking you to hold out for him, for his best and highest good for your life. And what if, instead of listening to that ugly snake, Adam and Eve had waited until the moment God walked with them in the evening to ask God, to seek the truth from the truth giver? God, is it true that if I eat this, things will be awesome? Is it true that you're holding out on us because we can't try this one fruit? Is that true, Lord? What if they had gone back to God and asked him about it? Because what God really said in Genesis 2 is you are free to eat any tree in this garden except for one. And so you are free. If you find yourself hidden in Jesus Christ and his blood this morning, you are free. Free from obsessing and consuming yourself with the one thing you want to have, and free to enjoy all the beauty that he has entrusted to you instead of what he has not yet. You are free. Let's switch gears for a minute. I was sitting in a room much like this one when a pastor and professor that I respect a lot asked us all a question. It's a room full of women Bible teachers. And she took a survey of the room, and she asked us, she said, "Hey, what fruit was it that Adam and Eve ate in the garden?" And a lot of people were like, "What did they say? Tell me." Apple. Everybody yelled apple, but wanting to be sophisticated and falling victim to the temptation of the pride of life, I was like, pomegranate. Just being honest, I fall for it too sometimes. And she was like, "Guys, listen, what was the leaf that they reached for whenever they had realized that they were sinned and they were naked?" Great question. I mean, I'm going to go for the closest leaf there is if I'm naked. Amen? They reached for a what leaf? Could it be, church, that the first fruit that Adam and Eve ate in the garden was a fig? And some girl all the way in the back, she just yells, "Shut up!" Just like that. She was so excited. We all were. I was like, my mind was blown because nobody had ever said that to me. Anybody ever heard that? I mean, that was a mind-blowing moment for me. But you see, I want you to understand, tradition holds that it was actually a fig that put us in the hole in the Garden of Eden, and it figures. Okay, thank you. All jokes aside, if you'll remember, Jesus had a run-in with a fig tree in Matthew chapter 21. I think it's in a couple of the other Gospels too. Several chapters before in Matthew 4, Jesus had been tempted by Satan with three different things. I wonder if you could deduce what those things were. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. If you go read that account, you'll see it so clearly. I don't have time to read it to you this morning, but you will see it. And I'm here to tell somebody in the house of God today that Jesus passed every one of those tests. Is that good news for people who can't pass the test? Thank you, Lord, that you were successful in overcoming the temptation of the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life. Because I can't, and I haven't. But Jesus did it for me. He passed that test. And so what I want us to do is go back to that fig tree. Jesus had passed the test. He's just made his triumphal entry into the city of Jerusalem. He's headed to the cross. And as he passes this fig tree in a very, I would consider random, seems random as you're reading it, he passes this fig tree and it appears to be very rich with blooms and it looks to be a life-giving tree. It looks to be successful. It looks to be fruitful. But Jesus comes closer and he realizes it only looks to be fruitful, that it isn't. And so he curses that fig tree. And next thing you know, that fig tree is all withered and twisted up. Do you see the imagery here? Because the tree looked pleasing to the eye. It looked to be good for food. It seemed to be full of promise and ambition based on the leaves, but it was a counterfeit. It was an imitation. And Jesus cursed it because that tree represented the twist of temptation and the fall of mankind. And that tree with this cheap imitation was the reason he came and the reason he was headed toward the cross. To set right what we had made wrong with our belief in the lie that the enemy told us. He cursed that fig tree that day because it was a representation of what he needed to accomplish for us, that he needed to defeat it once and for all and to kill off the cheap imitation so we wouldn't fall victim to it anymore. But that's not all we need to know about our little frenemy, the fig tree, okay? They're going to put up a slide from Revelation chapter 22, verses 1 and 2. Hear the word of God. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal. Can you just close your eyes for a minute and picture this? It was flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb and down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. You can open your eyes. What a beautiful picture. Amen. I cannot wait for that. I'm going there. I hope you are too. But most fascinating of all to me about this whole fig concept is that many scholars and messianic rabbis, Jesus-following rabbis in Israel, believe that the tree of life will be, you guessed it, a fig tree. A fig tree. Because what Adam and Eve used to hide their shame and their sin from God will now be used for the healing of the nations. Jesus has redeemed us from the curse of the fall by his blood. We will be free to eat of the tree that once broke us, because of God's unending mercy and redemption. Does that make you glad, church? Thank you, Jesus. And so the temptations that we face today, the temptations that you struggle with, are nothing but a poor imitation of the precious things that we already possess in Christ Jesus. And so whatever tempts you today, Jesus is better. Jesus is better than it is. Jesus is better. Isaiah 58, Holly told us yesterday, she reminded us of this. God will satisfy us. Jesus will satisfy us. And if you are fighting a battle against the devil today, you might be online, you might be here in this room, we want to support you. We want to pray for you. We want to carry you to Jesus so that you can receive victory. Please do not walk out of here still fighting that temptation by yourself. We're better together, aren't we? You like that? That was for you. This is what I want to say to you today. Wait for the Dr. Pepper, my friends. Wait for the Dr. Pepper. He will satisfy. His plan back in that Garden of Eden was to satisfy us all along. He knew that one day, one day we are going to sit under that tree together. I'm hoping you're all there with me, and we're going to sit under that tree together. And the leaves that they used to hide their sin will be leaves that God uses to heal us and to dry our tears. And I can't wait to sit there with you when everything is put right again. But until then, if you need encouragement in your struggle with temptation, or you want to meet this Jesus who's better than all of it for the first time today, we want to encourage you to head into this care room online. We want to encourage you to reach out. And our volunteers are going to be there to minister to you. I want you to believe that Jesus is better. May I pray for you?